Welcome to the Quincy Access Television Studios, the location for a debate between the candidates for mayor, incumbent Mayor Thomas Koch, and challenger, former Mayor William Phelan. The debate is being co-sponsored by Quincy Access Television and the Patriot Ledger. I'm Mark Crosby, Government Access Coordinator here at Quincy Access Television and the moderator for this debate. The format for this debate was agreed upon earlier by the candidates. To determine the order in which the candidates would respond, two coin flips were held earlier in the studio. The first coin flip determined which candidate would have the option to call heads or tails for coin flip number two. The winner of the second coin flip had the option to choose their desired position, first or second, for the opening or closing statement. During the next hour, the candidates will be questioned by our news panel. We have with us QATV broadcaster Joe Catalano, Patriot Ledger reporter Patrick Ronan, and Dave Skill of radio station WATD-FM. In addition, the candidates themselves will have a chance to question each other and respond to questions submitted by QATV viewers and Patriot Ledger readers. A timekeeper will notify each candidate when their allotted time has expired. Please be advised, candidates, that in fairness to each of you, the time will be strictly adhered to. We begin with a two-minute opening statement from Mr. Koch.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you to QATV and the Patriot Ledger and our panelists here today, and thank you to my opponent, Bill Phelan, for being here today. I'm very fortunate. I'm one of seven children, son of Dick and Simi Koch. Grew up in North Quincy. I had a wonderful upbringing, and the values instilled in me were work hard, treat others with respect, and give back to your community. And nobody did it better than my mom and dad over the years. I've carried those with me throughout my entire adult life. I was fortunate to be elected mayor in 2007. And since that time, we've been tackling some major issues facing our city. Some of those were issues dealing with infrastructure, some of our 53 municipal buildings, hundreds of miles of road and drainage and sewer and water mains, seawalls, flood-prone neighborhoods that needed to be addressed, a number of areas. And then, of course, we had a major issue that continues to haunt us, and that is the opiate issue. And I've continued to lead hitting these issues head on. I've had a wonderful experience being the mayor. It's been truly an honor and a privilege, but much work remains. We have stabilized our financial situation, our stabilization of our finances. Our bond rating has been increased. There's only three communities in Massachusetts with a higher bond rating. Our debt ratio is one of the lowest in the entire Commonwealth of Massachusetts among cities. We've continued to improve our schools, our education. Our school system is flourishing. We've done amazing work on our buildings, built two schools, about to build a third with the highest attainable reimbursement rates. We have rebuilt intersections. We have done all kinds of infrastructure work, leveraging your dollars with those of the federal and state governments. We continue to work with our colleagues at the federal level, at the state level, and at the local level, improving the quality of life of this great city. I look forward to the dialogue here in the studio today and ask for your vote on Tuesday, November 3rd.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Now we'll hear from Mr. Phelan.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you to the sponsors, and thank you to Mayor Koch for being here. I want to give a quick shout out, because we have a week left to go in the campaign, to all the campaign workers. They've worked so hard. I want to tell you I've made lifelong friendships from this campaign, and I appreciate all your hard work. I want to also acknowledge my three daughters and my son and my wife and tell them I love them. And lastly, I want to thank the thousands of concerned residents and taxpayers who I've had the great privilege to talk with over the course of this campaign. You were so kind to me. I will always remember your conversations. I listened, and what I heard really reinforced why I'm running for mayor. The city is spending too much money on things we don't need, and on the things we do need, we're not managing properly. Crazy spending is causing taxes to increase on seniors with fixed incomes and families that are struggling to make ends meet. We don't seem to have any vision for where we're going as a city, and developing willy-nilly, causing gridlock in our streets and really diminishing the character and quality of our neighborhoods. And I have to say, it's embarrassing after 8 years of this administration to see the condition of our downtown and the fact that we don't have a hospital and we're the largest city in the state without one. You know, we should be there as elected officials for those people who work hard, pay their taxes, and contribute to their community, and no one else. When I was mayor, I had a healthy respect for whose money it was I was entrusted with. Lowest tax increases of any city in the state for 6 years running, invested heavily in education, and set the table for great things to happen in our downtown. With your help, on November 3rd, we're going to move this city forward. Thank you.
Now we turn to questions from our panel. The candidate chosen to respond first will have 2 minutes for a reply, followed by a 60-second response from the other candidate, and finally 30 seconds for a rebuttal. We turn now to QATV broadcaster Joe Catalano.
Thank you, Mark. Mr. Koch, it's become quite obvious that development is the key issue during this campaign and in the city. Do you feel that there is a balanced mix of residential, commercial, and retail development going on across the city right now?
The simple answer, yes, Joe. The reality is in this real estate marketplace, the residential area is very hot. But we've seen over the last year, 18 months, a rebound in the commercial sector as well. For a number of years, there were two empty office buildings on State Street South, which are now nearly full. One of the developers of those buildings was looking to convert to residential and opted not to do that because they saw the strength in the commercial marketplace rebounding. Work on Boston Scientific, as you know, they've only used about half of that million square foot building for a number of years. And that other half is going to be used for another commercial entity, which is going to create hundreds of jobs at that site. So we'll continue to work with Mr. Quirk and Mr. Cashman at the shipyard. We've seen some growth at the yard and Mr. Cashman's site. And we'll continue to advance and market, if you will, Mr. Quirk's site at the shipyard. It's important that we continue to see responsible economic growth in both sectors, residential to deal with much needed workforce housing, but also the commercial sector, which helps us offset through the tax classification tax rate for the entire city, particularly the residential value. So the good news is property values are up across the board. And if you're a homeowner, that's what you want to see, that's your investment. That's where your nest egg is, if you will. And we are seeing, as I said, a resurgence in the commercial market, which is good for taxpayers, but it's also good for folks looking for jobs as well. So we'll continue to work with developers. We'll continue to work with my colleagues in government to make sure we continue to grow jobs, continue to grow the commercial market, and provide the workforce housing needed to meet the demands.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, you have 60 seconds.
You know, I've spoken to, like I said, thousands of residents at their door, and with all due respect, I don't think that balance is quite there. We're seeing development. Just because the economy calls for residential development doesn't mean that our city has to permit and allow and grant thousands of residential developments where we don't necessarily want them and away from the downtown in the business districts where we actually do want them. Developers are not your partners. They'll put 100 units on a postage stamp if you allow them, and this mayor seems to allow developers to get their way and not pay the mitigation and not guide the city's future in terms of development, despite what the economy might be and despite what developers might necessarily want. You have to stand up to special interests and make sure that the city's neighborhoods are not adversely impacted by that development.
Thank you. Mr. Phelan, Mr. Koch, you have a 30-second rebuttal.
Thank you. The reality is the economy is strong. We have good development. We've got to be careful not to allow for overdevelopment. We've strengthened the residential A zoning requirements for our city so that neighborhoods are protected. Our downtown development is underway. We have four developers at the table now. One building is going up in the air. Another one will be starting next month. So responsible development is important. The downtown is underway, and we're in a great position.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Patrick Roman, question for Mr. Phelan.
Mr. Phelan, you've said on the campaign trail that if elected, your plan would be to lower property taxes. Can you say specifically here today one budget item, one department, or one capital project you would cut or consider modifying in order to lower property taxes?
You know, that's a similar question that I was being asked back in 2001 when I was taking office. And I can tell you this, I can tell you what I did do and how I did it before. We took a $4.5 million deficit and turned it into a $17 million surplus. How did I do it? Not one silver bullet, believe me. We rolled up our sleeves, we dug into the budget, and we made some cuts. We reduced the workforce by over 100 employees through attrition, without hurting anybody, without laying anybody off. We collected 10 years of back parking tickets to create more revenues that, because we weren't hooked up to the registry of motor vehicles at the time, getting millions of dollars. We stood up to Quincy College, who had millions and millions of dollars in their reserve funds, yet were requiring the taxpayers of our city to pay for the pension obligations of their employees who lived elsewhere, taught elsewhere, and taught students from elsewhere. We went to a zero-based budget approach where each department head had to specifically explain every single expenditure that they were going to make and what that expenditure meant to the taxpayers of the city. So yes, every area of government can be reviewed, reduced, and looked at. I can only tell you this, that when I was mayor, for the 6 years I was mayor, we had the lowest tax increases of any city in the state with two exceptions. And we reduced taxes 2 out of 6 years. This mayor is going to tell you that I raised taxes more than he did. Yet, in last night at a debate, he started to show documents that he had to suggest that. But the fact is, twice as much in 1 year as I had in my 6 years combined, this mayor raised taxes.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, a 60-second response.
Sure. The reality is, the tax classification, property values, tax rate, rates go down, values go up, rates go down. The average single tax bill is what every administration has used for the last several mayors in comparisons. The reality is you had the largest single tax increase in 30 years, and that's the reality of it, $550. When I took office, we inherited unpaid bills, commitments that you made that weren't funded. You moved all kinds of money over into the sewer and water enterprise fund that the state ordered us back in that first budget. You lost 90% reimbursement for three school projects that was handed to you when you took office. You had a Honeywell program. You talk about reckless spending. The same company gave the study, the work, and the finance with no bidding at all. That's not good management. And it's cost you, the taxpayers, tens and tens of millions of dollars.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, a 30-second
rebuttal. Last night I did a little research and looked at the documents that the mayor was handing out. And in fact, the levy increased from 2002 to 2003 by approximately $7.6 million. When this mayor took office, the levy increased by over $20 million. The levy is how much you tax, mayor. You taxed almost three times in 1 year as the year you're referring to. And you know, I sat in the audience when that
Thank
school-
Thank you, Mr. Phelan.
Thank
Dave
you.
Skill, a question for Mr. Koch.
Mayor Koch, the $1.6 billion public-private investment with StreetWorks went down the tubes, and you say you have four developers who are in the mix now. What guarantee can you give to the citizens of the city of Quincy that this is going to work this time?
Well, there are no guarantees in life at all, Dave.
That's true.
The reality is we went into a program with the master developer, StreetWorks. We put together an amazing LDA, which the city council approved, and protected the city. StreetWorks had to meet certain milestones. They did not meet those milestones. Essentially, they couldn't get the investment and the funding because there wasn't enough yield in the program. So we made the decision to fire StreetWorks. I'm proud to say that the city was fully protected. Unfortunately for StreetWorks, they lost millions of dollars. Additionally, though, while StreetWorks was here, they had an amazing program of marketing. They got all the MEEP and permitting in place. And again, the city lost no dollars in this. So as we said, the dinner table has been set. We have different guests coming to dinner. Right now, we have Quincy Mutual, a 150-year-old company, which was an investor in the downtown, building the first phase, which is 169 units, as well as 14,000 square of retail on the first floor. We have the Galvin Brothers, known quantity in this city. They've been around some time, done a lot of development. They're developing 54 units of condominiums with 8,000 square feet of retail at the old Woolworth site. Mr. O'Connell has a proposal that's going to be going before the City Council that will be fully vetted sometime in November for our residential units. We're in discussions with two other investment companies that have come in and purchased private property in the downtown, and we'll continue to work with them and the City Council moving forward on those. So the downtown was talked about for 40 or 50 years, and yes, each administration probably made a contribution to where we are today, but nobody stuck their neck out like we have. And you need to take risk to have some success. So I'm proud of the record. We made the changes we needed to do. We're back on track, and it's actually happening in the downtown. We've leveraged all kinds of federal and state dollars on that project, and no taxpayer money is being used for those infrastructure improvements.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, 60 seconds.
You know, the mayor just said the plan was not financially viable, yet he entered into an agreement that took his eye off the numbers. It was a bait and switch, ladies and gentlemen. It was, hey, if we don't reach this milestone by this date, you don't have to do that. In other words, don't look at the numbers. Don't worry about the numbers. Well, I knew the numbers, and I went to the mayor's chief of staff, and I went to some of the councilors. I said, what are you doing? These numbers don't work. Keep your eye on the ball. We wasted critical time dealing with pie-in-the-sky plans. This mayor, 2 years ago, put a shovel in the ground for a development that the developers had never presented a financial plan for. It was unfeasible when he put the shovel in the ground. And either he didn't want to know the answer because it was an election year, or he didn't bother to ask the proper questions before he
proceeded.
Thank
you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 30 seconds.
The reality is a downtown is on track. We can look back. Mr. Phelan designated street works. When we took office, we began to work with that master developer. It didn't pan out. We rolled up our sleeves, and we're getting the job done. Things don't work out perfectly. And I must remind people that when I took office, we also, the greatest recession since the Depression hit, which had some bearing on the downtown and investors at the time. So let's keep the facts straight on this one.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Thank you to our candidates and to our panel of reporters for the first round. We will join them in just a bit for a second round of questioning. Next, we will conduct an open forum where the candidates will question each other. The candidate who asks the question will have 30 seconds. The candidate who responds will have 2 minutes to reply. A 60-second response to the reply and a 30-second rebuttal will follow. Mr. Koch, a question for Mr. Phelan.
Mr. Phelan, as been talked about, you were critical in my first year in office about the tax increase. And it was pretty clear by anybody looking at the facts that you left millions of dollars of unpaid commitments, payments for the Honeywell contract you negotiated, payments for contracts for employees, millions of dollars that was shifted over to the sewer and water to get it off of the regular budget, so in an election year you could show little tax increase. Had you been reelected, how are you going to deal with those numbers?
Mr. Phelan, you have 2 minutes to respond.
Thank you. Thank you for asking that question, because I've been dying to answer it. The fact of the matter is, Mayor, you didn't know how to budget when you first took office. You didn't. You completely knew nothing about how you offset general fund expenditures with water sewer money, and you made an $8 million mistake taxing people $8 million more than was necessary. And when it was called to your attention, you went into hiding when the Patriot Ledger reporter tried to contact your office, and you tried to come up with a reason to blame me. Now, were there bills that were outstanding? Absolutely there were. Every year there is. There's pluses and there's minuses at the end of the year. But every year I was in office, we ended on the right side of the ledger, and we would have ended on the right side of the ledger that year. The fact of the matter is, employee benefits, for example, some of the employees' unions hadn't settled yet. So we don't put money aside telling them how much of a raise they're going to get when we're in the midst of negotiations. It doesn't work that way, Mayor. You hold your cards when you're dealing with the unions. We would have funded those. We had plenty of money in reserves, and we had plenty of free cash that was coming. Honeywell, you keep talking about Honeywell. Last election, you would have thought that I was going to be taken out in handcuffs, for crying out loud. The Attorney General found that water conservation was not the same as energy conservation, so therefore it didn't technically comply with the statute, and that the water savings weren't guaranteed. Well, the fact is, the irony is, that we had more savings from the water portion of that Honeywell project than any other project. But just because you say things, Mayor, doesn't mean it's true, and you keep repeating it in
an
election
year. Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 60 seconds.
The reality is, I took office. We didn't add one program. We didn't add one job. Department of Revenue, you must be smarter than them, too. Department of Revenue came into the city and ordered the city to put those commitments back on the general revenue side because they should not have been put on the sewer and water side. You boasted about a Honeywell program that wasn't going to cost the taxpayers a dime. And the auditor came up to see me, where are you going to find the first payment to Honeywell? None of those things had been budgeted. You still didn't answer the question, what would you have cut out of schools, police, or fire, or how much would you have gone up on the taxes to meet the commitments that you made? The Inspector General found it so egregious, they turned it over to the Attorney General, who then settled with Honeywell to get the city out of a $22 million maintenance contract and a $4 million cash settlement with the city. You had it wrong. You had it wrong. Just admit it.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, you have 30 seconds.
You know, we can go on and on about 8 years ago, Mayor. The fact of the matter is, I had a bond rating that increased. I had $17 million reserves that I left you, and you didn't know how to budget, and you made a mistake. Your own auditors, and by the way, the Department of Revenue didn't order you to put that money back. Your own auditors the following year said you weren't taking enough money from water and sewer to offset the general fund expenditures.
Thank you, Mr.
like
Phelan.
I had.
Mr. Phelan, a question for Mr. Koch.
Now, this is a tough issue, but I'm gonna just come out and say it. Mr. Mayor, could you explain to me and the taxpayers of Quincy whether you had an improper financial relationship with Dan Flynn? You're a personal friend of his. Mr. Flynn has been indicted for money fraud, and he has had controversial financial dealings with the city, and I want to hear from you that the taxpayers of our city didn't suffer because of your personal relationship.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 2 minutes.
Sure, that's an easy one to respond to. I've known Dan Flynn since I was in first grade, and what has occurred is very, very unfortunate, and Mr. Flynn's going to have to answer to those charges. The reality is the city had no dealings with Mr. Flynn in any of his business transactions. The reality is, and when I took office and we started to deal with some of the flooding issues, we needed to build some pump stations. The engineering company came to us and cited a location on Furnace Avenue that we needed to build the pump station. When I found out that Mr. Flynn had been involved in that property, I immediately turned it over to the city solicitor and had nothing to do with the transaction. The city solicitor then began working with the bank because it was in foreclosure, and the bank was handling the matter. They wanted $650,000. The city purchased it for $450,000. This summer, FEMA, the federal government, recognized us for that location by giving us a grant for $5.3 million to build a new pump station at that site to relieve flooding for Miller Street, Cross Street, in the neighborhood surrounding that. Now, Mr. Flynn is in the land business. He's a real estate man. In 2007, you purchased a piece of land from the same Mr. Flynn, a piece of land purchased for open space that your own internal documents recognize that it was valued somewhere between $700,000 and $800,000. You put an appropriation before the city council and passed in one night an appropriation of $1.2 million. Mr. Flynn got no check from the city of Quincy in the transaction that I had on Furnace Avenue, but Mr. Flynn received a check for $197,000 from the city for the transaction on C Street. So, you know, he was in the land business. We both had transactions that related to Mr. Flynn. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, you have 60 seconds.
The difference is, in that transaction, we went to the city council. This mayor didn't go to the city council. Why? What was the rush? Nothing's happened with the land since, 3 years later. I did a little research, and I found out that this mayor had, Mr. Flynn had had an illegal fundraiser for this mayor in 2007 and was cited by the Office of Campaign and Political Finance for having violated the law with regards to it. I also found a note in the Registry of Deed that Mr. Flynn took out days before the city paid $485,000, three times the assessed value for Mr. Flynn's property. And the interest rate, annual interest rate Mr. Flynn was paying was 240% for a $200,000 loan taken out days before. My question is, we know that you paid too much, and we know Mr. Flynn was desperate for money. Why did you do it?
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 30 seconds.
I don't know how much more I can explain it. Those issues that we were dealing with that you ignored for 6 years, those flooding issues, we needed a piece of land to build a pump station. If we didn't have that piece of land, we wouldn't have got $5.3 million from the federal government this summer to build a pump station to relieve these issues of those folks on Cross Street and Miller Street and Crescent Street and that whole area of West Quincy. It's a natural low bowl, and that piece of land was at the low point of that bowl. From the engineer's perspective, it made perfect sense. We agreed with that, and we will be building
a pump
station.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Now, the candidates will answer questions submitted by Quincy Access Television viewers and readers of the Patriot Ledger. A total of two questions will be asked in this segment. For each question asked, the candidate responding first will have 2 minutes to reply, followed by a 60-second response from the other candidate, and finally 30 seconds for a rebuttal. And the first question. Mayor Koch and former Mayor Phelan, I have been watching the debate, and it has now gotten to the point where I am still undecided as to who I want to vote for as of this date. The reason being is that the debates are just the same subjects over and over again. It is getting old listening about street words and the cost of pens, just to name a couple of subjects. This is my question, and this question will go to Mr. Koch. Mayor Koch, please tell us something about former Mayor Phelan, something about his record that the voters in the city of Quincy have not heard in the debates.
Oh boy, I don't know what they haven't heard regarding either one of our records for that matter. We both have served obviously as mayor, we both have extensive records, I think much of those records have been discussed. The Mayor Phelan talked about, I want to talk about what happened 9 years ago. Well, that's the reality of when he was mayor. I've been defending my mayor for my record for the last six months or so. So I think it's fair game. So, I go back to some of those same issues. For example, Bill Phelan served on the school committee for 2 years. Actually, I supported you in that election when he ran for school committee. And then ran for mayor on one issue, and that was the high school. And 6 years later, the high school had not been built. There was a bogus groundbreaking that year, an election year. And all the while, he lost the 90% reimbursement rate that was fought for by our legislators. Now, the town of Milton had the same deal. The town of Milton got several schools built in that same time frame. But yet, the one issue that he ran on, he lost the 90% reimbursement and couldn't get the school out of the ground in that 6 years. So, the high school loan cost us $46 million more. That's all facts. And the Central Middle School and the Sterling Middle School funding was lost completely in that deal. So, I don't know what hasn't been discussed about Mr. Phelan's record, but certainly I am pointing out some of those very costly mistakes in his record that people should know about. There are new people in the city, and Mr. Phelan is a charming guy, but I think it's fair that we remind people of what went on during that time period when he did leave the city.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. I will continue with the question. Former Mayor Phelan, please tell us something about Mayor Koch's record that the voters in the city of Quincy have not heard in the debates.
Well, let's keep on the same subject matter. The school on the toxic waste dump, believe it or not, a lot of people probably weren't even around at the time. This mayor was planning the fields that were going to go on the toxic waste dump. I stood up and was the only elected official to stand up on behalf of students, teachers, and others who would have been subjected to that. The fact of the matter is that high school did receive 90%. I was in the audience watching as the ribbon cutting occurred, and Treasurer Cahill was thanked profusely for the 90% reimbursement that was received. I'm not sure what the mayor is referring to about Central and Sterling. I have no idea. I do know that the ground was broken on that high school in about the same time frame as it took this mayor to break ground in Central. He's built one school in 8 years. I built the high school in my 6 years, a very difficult one. One other area that you might not have heard about. When I became mayor, the teachers were the lowest paid in the South Shore. I gave them a contract that made them the highest paid teachers in the South Shore. We had a line item budget for health benefits that was $18 million, and 4 years later climbed to $36 million, had to be addressed. So I took a stand citywide relative to the cost of employee health benefits. I worked on a state task force, helped craft legislation at the state level, and negotiated with the police, the DPW, and the clerical workers, who all agreed to increase the share of health benefits that they pay. Then the teachers came along. My brother's a teacher. I couldn't negotiate. This mayor shook hands at the picket line with the teachers, and then after he was elected, took credit for the savings of $10 million that came on my back when I negotiated with our unions.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 30 seconds for a...
There you go again with the tales. It's unbelievable, the revisionist history. We negotiated hard, and under the law, we had to get more than 70% of the unions to go on board, because the unions come together under one group to deal with health insurance. That's the way it works. That's the way it is. We negotiated the GIC, which was a $10 million turnaround for the city of Quincy. That's the facts. I don't know what you're talking about in that regard. You know, folks, pay attention to the facts, because in all of these debates, they've been distorted pretty well.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Our next question to the both of you. What will both of you do to assure that private snow contractors will actually... I'm sorry. What will both of you do to assure that the private snow plow contractors will actually do the job when hired in wintertime? For years, there has always been a great disparity from neighborhood to neighborhood as to the width of the street after a storm. Are contractors actually given instructions on what is expected, and does the city ever inspect what they do? And this question will be posed initially to Mr. Phelan.
First of all, I won't accept campaign donations from the contractors. This mayor accepted $26,000 from those snow contractors that benefited from your taxpayers' dollars being wasted. $16 million in snow removal. Absolutely absurd. More than Worcester, who's larger than us, and Cambridge combined. And then we find that this mayor was accepting $26,000 of campaign contributions. What would I do? I'd hire a Department of Public Works commissioner that knows what they're doing. Our Public Works commissioner that was hired under this mayor not only flooded a neighborhood because they failed to close the floodgates, burnt city documents, but then we saw the horrendous job done managing the snow plowing this year. And nothing. When he came up in front of the city council, he said, well, that's not my job. It was the guy behind me. This was a political appointment that's going to cost taxpayers well over $1 million after he receives his pension for having his highest last 3 years of salary go towards his pension. So I'd hire people that knew what they were doing, and I'd manage properly. The planning takes place before the storm, not during the storm, not after you've gone down the middle of every roadway and done one strip, one width down every roadway, and then try to come back and fix it. That's not the way it works. The plan should be done beforehand. It was a historic snowstorm, no question about it, but those are the types of snowstorms that you plan for. When you don't have competent people in place, planning properly, you see the results.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, your response.
Well, first of all, the snow costs, heavy costs this winter was due to the historic winter we had with 9 feet of snow in almost 5 weeks. The comparisons my opponents have used all summer did not compare with communities that did the same effort we did, which was to remove snow street by street in virtually every neighborhood. Boston did it, we're about the same per road mile. Somerville did it, and they paid more per road mile. The reality is it was a very difficult winter, and we tackled it head on. We do meet each year. We get together with all the contractors, with all our employees. We have what we call chasers that are assigned to various snow routes. During the time I've been mayor, we've increased the equipment available in each of these areas because when I took office, a lot of the routes would just pick up trucks. They couldn't handle pushing the snow back. We now have a program where we do have the proper equipment to do that. I heard from communities all around us, people that worked in Quincy, the marked difference when they got to Quincy in the situation with the roads versus the towns that they lived in. So listen, nobody's perfect, but when you did get 9 feet of snow in 4 or 5 weeks, it was historic. It was very difficult, but we had every street open. Our public safety equipment was able to get up and down every street of our city. And when you look back, it's the historic 78 with the blizzard. It's ironic, public transportation was working and the roads were closed for 10 days. In this case, the roads were open the entire time for public safety vehicles. So I'm proud of that. More work can be done, absolutely. We have a good team. We tackle it each year. Specifically answering the question, yes, we do meet with the contractors, we meet with the chasers, we come up with a plan, a strategic plan going in. Under my administration, we purchased a salt shed, which allows us now to store up to 5,000 tons of salt, so we're prepared. So when we do have shortages, when you have a historic snowfall, we're able to have it on hand to deal with the situation. So much work has been done. We've incrementally improved the budget over the years so that we can meet the challenges of our winters.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, you have 30 seconds.
I think what you just heard the mayor say is he wouldn't do anything differently. So we would have the same result if he didn't do anything differently. He said he heard from residents saying how much of a marked difference it was when they came into Quincy. Well, I heard from residents that said the same thing, only they told me that it was horrendous in Quincy. So I'm not sure who the mayor was referring to. The fact of the matter is, the city didn't manage this storm properly, wasted taxpayers' dollars, and then the mayor benefited contributors as a result.
The questions were once again provided by QATV viewers and Patriot Ledger readers. And now for our second round of questions from our panel. Joe Catalano will ask the first question of the second round to Mr. Phelan. Joe?
Mr. Phelan, Mayor Koch has often said that the city is taxing below the maximum allowed by Proposition 2.5, leading to an excess levy capacity. If elected, would you continue that practice, or would you dip into that excess levy capacity?
It depends on a lot of different factors. I will say this. This mayor is taxing too much because he's spending excessively, and I can list a number of ways that he's spending excessively. $38 million for a park that's been torn up in front of City Hall for over a year with no real money identified except your tax dollars to pay for that park. Absolutely incredible. A City Hall project that went from $7 million to $15 million with no real explanation as to why, and why were we gutting a historic City Hall from the dirt floor to the rafters, paying and not managing properly a snow budget, millions of dollars wasted, taking people's homes for more than what they were valued at for the construction of a parking lot. All these expenditures, excessive spending really, is causing taxes to be increased on our seniors on fixed incomes. I had a conversation with a woman who was 82 years old and lived in a state of anxiety because her income wasn't going up and she didn't know how she was going to pay her tax bill. I had to explain to her, because there obviously isn't enough outreach, that she can defer those payments and only pay 2% interest rather than 10% because of an initiative that I implemented while I was the mayor of this city. When I was mayor, we had the lowest tax increases of any city in the state, with two exceptions. We decreased taxes twice. This mayor can say whatever he wants. He increased taxes twice as much in 1 year as I had in my 6 years combined.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 60 seconds.
Yes, so we do have excess levy capacity. If we were taxing at the max, it would be probably closer to about $700 per average single family, more than what people are paying today. I take the job very seriously, and I think we're very responsible in how we approach things. It's always trying to strike the balance. The city has needs. There's been neighborhoods and issues that have been ignored for decades that have been to deal with. So we've been investing in our neighborhoods. We've been investing in our infrastructure. We've been investing in our schools. And all the while, we're getting the highest reimbursable rates to leverage your tax dollars at home. Whether it's intersections that the federal and state governments are paying for, whether it's Central Middle School, where we get the 80% highest reimbursable rate, or other work that we're doing to our schools and other facilities where we're getting up to 70% reimbursement from the state, it's being proactive. It's going out and bringing those dollars back to our city. So it's being responsible with your tax dollars, striking the balance of responding to your needs in the neighborhoods and dealing with the issues that we face with our infrastructure.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, 30 seconds.
You know, I've just talked to so many people and they're concerned about the excessive spending, but let me talk a little bit about the city's financial health. The mayor keeps on saying his bond rating increased. I have an email from the bond rating agency saying that the reason it was increased because they changed their criteria. And then in June of this year, they shifted from stable to negative the city's outlook because of poor management, no planning, deficit spending over the last 2 years, and I have a copy of that.
Thank you,
report.
Mr. Phelan. Patrick Ronan, a question for Mr. Koch.
Mayor Koch, when you ran for mayor in 2007, you promised to implement a citywide traffic plan. 8 years later, with traffic either the same or worse in some parts of the city, what happened to your plan?
We've actually been implementing improvements directly to a number of major intersections. And these things don't happen overnight. But for example, Hancock and East and West Quantum Streets, which was a rated F intersection for 20 years, has been completely rebuilt with federal and state dollars, 75% of which they paid. That was an intersection that is now C, so it is improving that situation. Quincy Avenue, East and West Howard Streets, was an intersection that was dangerous, misaligned, and a lot of accidents there. Completely rebuilt with federal and state dollars. We have MassDOT now spending $1.2 million to redesign C Street from Palmer Street all the way up to Southern Artery around to Broad Street. Improvements to our traffic situation. We've worked with our legislative delegation, which has helped to pay for the rebuilding of the Ponset Bridge. We've had some of our railroad bridges rebuilt over the tracks that connect us east-west across the city. The Four River Bridge is going through a complete new construction project where we're going to have a $240 million brand new bridge that serves the people of the city and the South Shore. And that is the other challenge here is we are next to Boston. We're a commuter city and we have an awful lot of traffic that comes up from 3A, and as the expressway backs up, people jump off and cut through our city, whether it's morning or evening commute. So I think we've made progress. We continue to make progress. We have engineering companies that work with our infrastructure engineer to look for and to identify those choke points and areas where we can continue to make improvements. But again, these things cost money. We've got to be responsible and strike that balance. And I think we have made great progress on all our infrastructure, including intersections. But of course, more work needs to be done, and we'll continue to work the issue.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, a 60-second response.
You know, our city is facing gridlock. I don't have to tell you. The fact that this mayor ran 8 years ago stating he was going to give the citizens of Quincy a master traffic plan and to date just acknowledge he doesn't have any such plan is an indication that we need change. This mayor is allowing development to go into our neighborhoods and in our city willy-nilly. When I was in the mayor's office, we directed development to the downtown. We made sure that infrastructure was present before we allowed development to occur. We were able to pass a district improvement finance zone, get funding, permit, design, and begin construction on a roadway that had been in the plans for 30 years in order to support new development. That's smart growth. Just because developers want to put unit after unit after unit in our city doesn't mean they should be allowed
to. Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, a 30-second rebuttal.
We have more work to do. We are working with our traffic engineer, DPW folks, and our infrastructure engineer to identify those projects and continue to make those improvements. You know, I continue to hear Mr. Phelan talk about my sweetheart relationships with developers. I've never stayed in a developer's home on Martha's Vineyard for my family vacation. The reality is we're a city next to Boston with challenges, and we continue to show visible improvements to those challenges.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. We turn to our panel. Dave Skill, a question for Mr. Phelan.
Topic that hasn't really come up yet, dealing with diversity. The makeup of Quincy has changed certainly over the years, having grown up on the South Shore myself. We have many races, different ethnic backgrounds, the Asian population about 25%. What will the Phelan administration do to meet the needs of these folks?
That's a great question, Dave. Really it is, and our city is changing, and it's really changing for the better. We have to embrace our diversity. When I grew up in Quincy, you know, I went to high school, and I would say it was not a diverse high school in the least. I've had the great privilege of meeting so many wonderful young people that are in our school system. You know, my kids had friends from all around the world. One story I always tell, we had the pictures for a prom out in front of our house, and I'll tell you, the colors of the kids out there were as diverse as the colors of the dresses that the young girls were wearing. It was incredible. So what do? We try to provide a city government that reflects the community in which we live. When I was mayor, we called for a gender-specific civil service list, hiring more women, one. We called for a language-specific civil service list so that we could hire Cantonese and Mandarin-speaking police officers. We had a Citizens Police Academy to outreach to our Chinese senior population to educate them and get them acquainted with the power structure of the city and their government that's there to serve them. We can always do more, but communication is the key. We hired people from Chinese background and Vietnamese background in the building inspector's position, in the election division, in the treasurer's office. My staff always had a senior member staff that was of a diverse background. So we can always do more, but the fact of the matter is our city is strong because of its diversity and because of the differences that we have as
Thank
a people.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, you have 60 seconds.
Sure. This city is a great city, and that's why so many immigrants are moving to this city. I'm a grandson of a German immigrant who had a store in North Quincy, and we have done extremely well. My family was so blessed because of the greatness of this city. So we got to continue to welcome everybody. Over the last few years, we've added about 43 folks in various positions, schools, libraries, and others, that reflect some of that diversity that we have in our city. But I would remind everybody that, you know, people are moving here because we have great schools, the crime is low, our open spaces and parks are second to none, we have amazing library services, which hours are extended now more than they were in the 1980s. We have a senior center that was built just a few years back that provides opportunity for our seniors, more than 4,000 members. So there's a reason people are coming here. It's a great city. I'm proud of our city and certainly welcome all to participate in our government.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Phelan, 30 seconds.
So truly, you know, we can celebrate our differences. We had a cultural fair when I was in office that celebrated all the different ethnicities that live in our city. But we always have to remember what our similarities are, what we all care about: family, hard work, and education. You know, when I was mayor, we invested heavily in the school department, nearly twice as much on average annually than this mayor has. That's what most folks care about.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Candidates will now have 60 seconds for closing remarks. Once again, the order determined by a coin toss in the studio prior to the beginning of this debate. Mr. Phelan, we begin with you.
Well, thank you. It's been just a wonderful experience campaigning this year. And And people ask me all the time, why are you doing it again? Why do you put yourself out there? And I try to say what drives me. When you're the mayor of this great city, you get to help people every single day you're in office. And you also get to guide the city's future in ways that might encourage your children to raise their families here, just like we did. And I see what's going on in this city. I see the mismanagement. I see the excessive spending. And I know I can help. With your help, we can have the type of city in our future that we know it can be, a city that will reach its potential. Please, I ask humbly for your vote on November 3rd. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Phelan. Mr. Koch, your closing remarks.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you, everybody, for listening. It's been a privilege to serve as your mayor these last 8 years. My opponents talked about reckless spending and mismanagement. And during his tenure, those 6 years, he lost tens of millions of dollars because he mismanaged a school program that was handed to him for 90% reimbursement, and he had signed one of the worst contracts in state history with Honeywell. We've been tackling our issues head-on since I've been in office. Our bond rating is up, our debt ratio is down, our schools are flourishing, crime is down, we've seen improvements all across the city in our infrastructure. We continue to meet those challenges, whether it's opiate issues or whatever the issue may be, we've tackled them head-on facing the city. So it's been a privilege and an honor, and we have much yet to do. We want to complete the great work we've started on our downtown. We want to complete the improvements we're doing in our infrastructure. So on Tuesday, November 3rd, think hard, look at the records, do your homework. The choice is clear. I ask for your vote Tuesday, November 3rd. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Our sincere thanks to the candidates, our panelists, the production team here at Quincy Access Television, and thank you, of course, for watching. A special thank you to the Patriot Ledger for co-sponsoring the debate. Remember to vote in the municipal election on Tuesday, November 3rd. This is your city. Help to ensure its bright future by electing a leader who best represents your views, is mindful of this city's rich heritage, and is dedicated to facing any challenges that lie ahead. I'm Mark Crosby. Once again, thank you for watching.